Listen, all this takes a lot of getting used to. And you do get used to it after a while. There's three things I'll always miss, though. One, not having to watch my step all the time. Two, forget about two. And three, I miss the songs. Folks from Ceylandia knew how to carry a tune. Sure, we've got some songs on the old gramophone, but try and imagine what they sounded like playing to a room full of fine people, unwinding at the sole regret after a hard day's work. Those were the days.
Alright, hey guys, let me know how the audio is, and then I'm gonna give me 1 minute to just post on Twitter, let everyone know that we are now live. I don't know why, but TweetDeck is super slow. Like, there's always a huge lag when I'm typing, which is really, really annoying. Okay, so hello. I just realized my video is actually frozen for me. Alright, that looks like it should be fixed now. Anyway, I wanted to show you guys kind of this really cool effect I just discovered. So basically what I have been doing is trying to make... I've been thinking about making a bunch of posters. Not right now, but I want to do it maybe at the end of the summer, that are inspired by architectural posters. So I'm talking about stuff like this. That's basically in like it from an orthographic camera. So I thought about trying something, and then I ended up getting this. It ended up looking very weird, like this. So I'm going to show you guys what I did and what happened. All right, Latravis, thank you. I'm glad that looks like the audio and video are both working fine. It is in the game development channel. Yeah, actually, so on Monday, there was like no one here because I wasn't on, I wasn't actually on the game development channel. But I think I am in the directory now this time. But yeah, anyway, we won't worry too much about that. Alright, cutting out a lot? Okay. So, hey, son of G-Dates, how's it going? So... Hi, David. Sorry to hear that it's cutting out for you. Hopefully it'll get better. So anyway, you guys know this is the level that we've been working on for some time, and I thought about, well, let's see, I would like to make a poster that's based on this. Hello, Red Bulbs! But from an orthographic perspective, right? Like similar to that poster I just showed you. So kind of more like this, but with the edge detection applied and sort of with a sense of depth. So what I did was I took the camera, and you can change it to orthographic. Now what's really nice is you can look at it here. This is the preview of what the player camera is seeing. Now what you have to do is you have to change the size of it. So let's do that. And now I'm gonna jump back into the game. And this is what I get. I get this like weird, I'm not sure why, but I get this like, hold on, this is, so for some reason I end up having these like four, it's like it like the reflection of it is being drawn. Like you guys can see here in the top right left corner with the edges. That's really what I want. I don't want this like, hello, C. Goodrow, how's it going? Yeah, I know this is not intentional, right? And you can see that when we are in, like, this is what the camera preview is. So for some reason, these, like, I just want this top left part. I don't know why, where these other ones are coming. I'm guessing it's something to do with the way my edge detection. So actually, we can change the, oh, it looks like it has to do with, maybe if we lowered the far clip plane by a lot. No, I don't know. So I don't know why the reflection is happening. Let's make this 800, 0. And if I make the size of it a lot bigger, you can see it ends up being... I mean, I think this looks really cool. It's just not at all what I wanted it to look like. And then here's something really cool is as I start moving around here, it ends up, you get this like really cool kaleidoscopic effect. And like, okay, you see that? Like right here, like just those, that like depth, this area, that looks beautiful to me. It's just that gradient in the colors. But I don't know where this is from. I'm guessing it has to do with the depth texture. Like my, I'm pretty sure it's my edge detection shader because it's not meant for orthographic camera. And I think the way the depth normal texture comes in between perspective, right? That's perspective and orthographic. They're just not. Yeah, it's just making it's very different. So, but I do think that kind of stumbled on something that is very cool. That's me. I'm pressing W right now, so I'm moving through. Whoa! That was like a sweet spot right there. Like that, this here, that looks awesome. That looks really, really beautiful. A different angle, so this is, yeah. So all I can do really is rotate. So this is like looking from the bottom. This is looking from the top, but I just don't understand why it seems to be drawing it four times. And I do think this is really cool. Just this visual, this kaleidoscopic effect. But it's not at all what I want. Yeah. But I do think it is really cool, so I just don't understand why it's happening. And you can see it's being rendered in a number of different times. Like I think this is depth. This is definitely the depth texture. And I think this is probably the original without the edge detection shader. Here we see the edges being drawn. So it's like it's getting rendered like four times and all in a very, very different way. Yeah, but I don't like this is that not what I was going for, but it was sort of a happy accident. So I kind of wanted to show you guys this Bozo to record the video so I can replicate the steps. Like, no, I didn't want to. Right, like right here. Oh my god, why do I keep hitting the wrong? Okay, and then when I get the right, like right here, that is the actual blue with the edges. For some reason all these other stuff is getting drawn. I was thinking of trying this with some of the other levels to see what they look like. So let's take a look at the stepwell level. Don't save. All right, so this is the stepwell level. Let's take a look at it. This is what it looks like normally. Oh no, I spoiled it. Sorry, so like, okay, this is not, This is not, I wasn't intending to show you guys this at this stage, but this is, oh man, yeah, you're right. So, Infinite Water. I did not mean to, I just, because David was working on it, he was working on it this in this level, and I totally forgot he had implemented it. I didn't want to show you guys the waterfall just yet, but here it is. So I was saving it as a surprise for a stream a little bit later, but anyway, you can see this is what Infinite Water is going to look like, which I am super excited about. And eventually it won't look like this. This is just like temporary artwork for the water, but eventually it's going to, and it looks super cool already, but you know, eventually we'll have it in waterfall, so it's also coming down from above and not just sort of traveling down these steps. Yeah, can I toggle the screen effects off one at a time? That is, see, Goodrow, that is a good point. Why don't we, since we're here, let's just go ahead and try it with this to see where the problem is. So let's go ahead, orthographic. Actually, it's a lot easier to do the scene view and look at the camera. I'm gonna switch to, I'm gonna toggle no clip so I can fly around. Oops, it looks like, toggle HUD. So let's go ahead and do what, well actually first of all let me disable the console, and we're gonna do what C. Goodrow suggested, which is I'm gonna turn off my, so you can see I've got a ton of stuff going on. Okay, it's not amplify color. I am almost certain it's my edge detection shader. Yeah, right? Like, it's my edge detection shader. Because it's like, I want it to look like, it's like really freaking hard to travel with this. Like, how do I, yeah, no, it's my edge detection shader. I think it just doesn't, okay. See this? I want this with edges, right? I want this with edges. Yeah. Like what I want is, imagine a poster with this pattern and the edges. So yeah, it is my edge detection shader. I think it's because it's not, it doesn't, when you're in orthographic, it reads depth in a very, very different way. Yes, yeah, I do think water is going to add a very huge sense of space. Actually, you know what, since... Ah, okay, I see. Since I've already spoiled the water, I'm going to show you guys this one picture, this one test we've done, which is what Infinite Waterfall is going to look like in the end. So you can see basically as it falls off, so there's no such thing as a waterfall, there's only water loops, because as it falls off the edge, it actually comes back down from above. So this was like a test we're doing with the water stuff. So yes, so as you can see, my streams are all definitely live. All right, so this is what the game looks like without my edge detection shader. I do think it looks cool, just it's very hard to see stuff. All right, so anyway, let's go back to our, actually, you know what, I want to try one more level. No, don't save. Yeah, it seems like there's just a problem with the way the edge detection shader is handling depth in orthographic camera mode. black outlines. Yeah, the black outlines is edge detection. Is the edge detection shader still based on difference in the angles of the normals? It's based on both normals and depth. Alright, I'm just curious what this one is gonna look like. Alright, let's change the, let's make it orthographic, let's increase the size of it. So I mean, this looks super cool. But yeah, it seems like by changing, it does have something to do with the depth, because by changing the, whoa, that looks really cool. So by changing the near clipping plane value, I can kind of clean it up a bit. Right. It's just too unpredictable what's going to happen. Right, and then at some point it seems to then go back around. I mean, I do really like this effect. Yeah, I mean, that does just look super cool. I just don't understand why it's drawing it so many times. I'll have to do some more research into the orthographic camera to figure out what the problem is exactly. Anyway, let's go back to the Redux level. And I can talk about, okay, no, I don't want to save that. So we will come back to this, the Redux level, and I'm going to show you guys the... Yes. I'm going to show you guys kind of how, what I'm doing with the interlockable. So right now I'm basically just designing a bunch of puzzles that are super complex. Let me see if there's anything new that's been pushed. No. Okay. Not today. So, yeah, so I wanted also to talk about, because Jet User was thinking that the interlockables have something to do with like an optimization problem. Now that's actually not the case. So for example, for this puzzle, that's where the activator switches, and we want to connect all these pieces together. So you can see there's a line here. There's a line on this purple-orange piece. There's a line on this C-shaped red-blue piece, and there's a line here. And now, what this one requires you to do is first you have to bring these two down here. And now I don't think I would actually have a puzzle like this in the game, because it is like way too insanely complex. Because what you have to do first is you want both of these to fall down, but you don't want the Z-shape one to fall as well. You only want the C-shape one. So what you gotta do is you use this yellow-green one to hold the C-shape one up. So watch this. I'm gonna rotate onto this. Okay, you see now it's holding this one, this Z-shaped piece up. And then what you can do is rotate onto blue. See, this one is held up. This one lands. Okay? And again, now I don't want this purple piece to fall all the way down, right? So I'm using this other piece to hold it up. So this is like super way too complicated, so it's really hard to see. But this for me was more just of a test. So to see like if it can handle various edge cases. So now I want the edge piece to slide down. What I gotta do is move this yellow green block out of the way. And it is making me a little bit motion sick, because there's a lot of looking at this drawing space, so I don't think I want to abuse this. But basically, you know, now you've connected all these pieces. Anyway, I'm curious to hear what you guys think of a puzzle like this. This is obviously too much, right? But watch, I put this, and that's going to light up. And now that door is open, because we've generalized this into a system where every line is just a wire and it can connect to other lines, all of them. Now, as soon as I rotate, see this door is opened. As soon as I rotate into red, watch it breaks the line, right? Like that is still lit, but it's waiting for a connection piece to join it. So, yeah, I don't think in the game I would actually have something quite as complex as this, just because it's a little too... This one is a little... There's too many steps involved. But I think something a lot simpler, but with more interesting cases... And I think visually, these also need a lot of work to look good. So that's the interlockables. I'm going to be building more. Yes, it is. It is like they're basically acting like bridges that you can combine. And the cool thing too is, let me show you guys with. This would be a good place to demonstrate it. No, let's do this one. So here I have this piece. Yes, yeah, they are intended to be used as bridges, and it's something you can do. You can actually even combine it with water to do really crazy stuff later on in the game. Alright, let's move this piece down. Find it right out to here. Alright. Actually, let's move this whole thing here. So the you know, everything, all the systems are super consistent and work across with everything. So I want to show you, and this goes for the giant interlockables as well. So let me find, where is that puzzle? It's been a very long day for me. Ah, okay, here it is. Right. Fuck. Alright. I am going to try to land in the correct position this time. Okay. So you see this piece, right? So when it's green, it's falling this way. But it works with wheel wrapping, so that means if we rotate onto yellow gravity, we'll actually see it fall down here. And then we should actually see it come down from above at some point. Oh man, I hope this works. Okay, maybe it's not working right now. No, wait, I think it is. Just have to be patient. Either that or it got caught on something. Also, the wheel wrapping is like really massive now. Huh, okay. That should have worked. Let's actually try to... Give me a second, I'm gonna try to debug it. Yes, because... I did not have the correct script applied to the object. So, there we go. Alright, let's try that again. Let's move rigid body controller. Okay, let's move the player to this scene where they need to be. So here we'll put them all the way up here. Alright. So we're gonna try that rotation, and what you should see is it should come down from the other side, so it can actually, like, top and pot, you really have to rethink what is top and what is bottom. Is this the side? No. I think it's the other side. The reason why this debug wheel has to be so big is because there's so much stuff in it. Okay, let's see. Okay, you see these LPs right now? It's in the green gravity, and if we rotate into orange, we'll see it fall down. And then we should see it come down from above. Ah, there we go. Right, so we've basically brought it onto the other side in a different orientation. Oh my god. Oh no, never mind, it's in the same. I totally thought we like discovered another cool mechanic, but no. It's all good. So in a way, it's almost like you can get it past the wall, which is, I think, is a really interesting consequence, and that's something that I want to utilize in a puzzle, as opposed to making it super tedious. No, see, I was just confused, because I was expecting it to land down like the L shape, but it landed up that way, which is the correct way. Right, but it's like we basically pushed it through this wall to the other side. And I think that's something that's really interesting. And something that I would like to use in a... yikes. Alright. Now let us work on... tree generating. Okay, we are actually going to start writing some ProBuilder scripts. Had to make some of these boxes. But any desire to recreate it in perspective view? The problem is the ortho view is totally a bug and it's not intentional. Like, it's my perspective view shader effect gone wrong in the ortho view, and so I don't know what happened. I don't know what it's what made it look that way. I mean, it looks cool. I want to make it in, I don't think I'll actually put it in perspective view because there's no gameplay around it, but it just looks super cool. So I might kind of just like make some really cool looking posters with it, but probably not for gameplay. I'm going to get some coffee before I start this tree, so I'll be right back. Oh, I spilled coffee on my keyboard. All right. Yes, no, actually, just normal water. Man, my video keeps freezing up in my dashboard, which is really weird. I think I follow Twitch support news now, and I think there's been a lot of things that need to get fixed. Let me refresh that. Oh, so on Friday, when we're going to have Ian Sundstrom, who is a Bloomington indie developer, on the stream talking about stacks on stacks on stacks. And, yeah, so that should be fun. Anyway, let's start working on, let's just write, let's start with the tree generating script. So I'm gonna open up my generate ProBuilder script, so I have an idea of what exactly to do. All right, so you can set the position, set the box slider. Wait, which game is this? I had to refresh the stacks on stacks on stacks. Yes, that is the game. We'll be playing it and talking about it, and Ian will be on the show to answer questions and have a design discussion. So, all right, just wanted to refresh my mind on how exactly using ProBuilder to generate stuff works. And now we're going to check out the project folder and start working on... All right, let's start with our tree generator. By the way, thanks so much for watching. I know Just in case you guys aren't already aware, Handmade Hero is also streaming right now. the number, just like everyone leaves and goes to watch Handmade Hero. Alright. We'll need our Pro Builder library. And we want to execute an edit mode. Alright, I am going to... He's done streaming. Oh, okay. Man, the thing, so Handmade Hero looks super cool. The problem is, like, I feel like you have to start from the beginning. Otherwise, you just can't follow what he's doing. And at this point, it's like every show that you miss, it feels harder and harder to get back into. So, alright, I am just going to start off with making a... box. For now, let's not get too complicated. We're gonna start off just making the tree trunk. We're not even gonna do this for loop. Okay, so we have to have a game object. We set the size. Okay, let's not get too complicated. Let's just make it like a 5x5x5 box and make sure that that works. And then we'll start with the trunk. Yeah, and I was like that to me is, I think it's super cool, Handmade Hero, and I'd love to watch it one day. But the thing is, it's like, that's really more about learning programming than it is about actual game development, because it's not like that one is learning game development first as opposed to making a game first. I guess they left and came here. So what I mean is whereas I feel for me it's like this isn't about learning game development, right? This is like I'm really just trying to get this game out there at this point. Which I think is more real. Alright, so, okay, we got the size. We are going to, so this is like the Pro Builder script. PB object, PB equals to PB shape generator. Right, so that is PB shape generator, we call it dot cube generator. By the way, I'm also going to have, I've been talking to Gabriel Williams. He is one of the guys, he started Pro Builder. Carl is another programmer that's also working on Pro Builder. I'd love to get one of them on the show sometime. It'd be super cool to talk about their stuff. And I also talked about some of this, like, procedural generation I'm doing. Okay, so that's how you color things. Right, so that's the, let's make it, whatever this color is. So you gotta color it for each face. So I'm doing vertex coloring. This is vertex coloring. Right, size. I have to write comments like this. Otherwise I can't read my own code. So Pro Builder object. Pro Builder PB API, obviously. Oh, hey, Boston, Mass. Hey, thank you. That's really cool. I mean, so, well, the game is Relativity, but it's, yeah, there's more of it. It's coming out on PS4, PC, hopefully next year, but you can see it's like Antechamber meets Darcy Pilgrim with a lot of really cool stuff as well. And I'm trying to make a tree generator so that I don't have to build stuff by hand. Where did my script go? Right, so that should be float size. The white text on a black background is the game? What? Oh, Yes, yeah. I am always down to talk about why is this not working? Oh, right, because you know why? Because that is not a float. That is a... It's interesting. So there's they have their own... Right, so that's vertex coloring. Okay, we set my cube to this game object. We set the position. Let's just set it at the origin. Set it at the origin. I don't actually... Not sure if I need a box collider right now. And we'll make a... We'll make a boolean to say geo-generated equals to false. And this is just so... This is mostly to make sure that the game doesn't crash when you are generating stuff in the editor. Because sometimes with these procedural generation stuff, they can get stuck in the loop. So this is to make sure, right, okay, so it only does it when geo-generated is false. Once it runs through it once, it makes it true, so it won't do it twice. And, alright, so let's create an empty object. We'll call it tree generator. Hello? Yeah, so I'm getting like just a ton of problems because of all, I have so many errors that it really slows down the editor. Okay, so there you are. This is the tree generator. All right, we are going to attach this tree generator script to that. Oh, first of all, this is public bool. And I think it may actually already have generated a tree. In fact, I think it's this, right. Okay, so we colored it this color. So this is the box, right? So we want to take this and we want to generate, let's generate the trunk. So we're gonna generate like a one, okay, right, so gonna go here, we're gonna say void create trunk, and I think the trunk should take in a size as the input parameter. Hey, yeah, I really wish more people knew about it. It is one of those explore the rules. It's a lot of trial and error, but it's fantastic. You just have to play it. It's a lot about mystery and discovery. In fact, Manja, I think you would like it a lot. So let's do size. And position. Because I think its position would have to come from its great permutators trailer. Let's take a look. This looks like Infinite Factory. Yeah, Star Seed Pilgrim is a very different, has a very different vibe. Yeah, this looks pretty clear. I mean, I get a very clear sense of what this is about and what I can expect. It looks like Infinite Factory. I mean, I know this came out before Infinite Factory, but I mean this like, right, I mean, it even tells me here. So I see Pilgrim's got like a very different philosophy. Yeah, like, Okay, I think Starseed Pilgrim is, to me, it might not be... I really think Starseed Pilgrim is, like, one of the most beautifully designed games ever. It's not the most fun game to play, but it's very, very beautifully designed. It's like poetry and puzzle, yeah. Alright, so... my trunk. Let's call this my trunk. So this is the thing to generate trunk pieces. We also want its rotation. Wait, John didn't play Great Permutator because of the conveyors? Trunk size. He thought it was too much like Infinifactory, I see. This came out before Infinifactory, though. Ugh. Alright, so this is... So actually, we want to make sure that the... Like, I'm trying to think, because the trunk... I'm wondering if I should have a different function for the trunk than the branches, and I think yes. The thing with the trunk is that it's always... I feel like the trunk should always be... We should rotate it, so not worry about... I really don't want to have to do matrix math later. Right, so I'm basically, eventually I'm going to need set rotation. And I have it in my fractal generator script where I basically pass on rotation from one to another, but I really, really hate working with quaternions. So the thing with the trunk is I actually really only need the height, right? Because I know it's going to be new vector 3. It's going to be 1.5f, height 1.5f. Of course, what I should do is up here have, let's do serialized field, float trunk width. Because this is all stuff I'd eventually would want to adjust. So this is, we will make this trunk width. Trunk width, and this will be trunk size. And so actually now, instead of calling this at the beginning, we are just going to straight up call create trunk. Actually we do need the vector 3. Position equals to vector new vector 3. Do not try to learn programming from me. This is not how you want to do things. Quaternion rotation equals to quaternion dot identity. Yeah, let's just say this. And what we will do is we will say create trunk. Let's just say let's make it 5. Let's create a trunk that's 5 length, position, rotation. So, now what should happen? Why? Oh, right, because that should be a quaternion and not a vector 3. Okay, now the thing is, I don't actually want to make it. Actually, you know what? I don't want to generate it there. I want to generate it in transform.position. I want to generate it in the position of the tree generator. Okay, so that's already been generated. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna unclick this. Hello, fat guy 925, hello. Programming a language is like French. As long as you learn, someone else will correct you. I think that's just another language, yes. But you know, every time you get corrected, it I suppose you improve in a bit, so it's good. Hello, and hello. Thanks for stopping by the stream. Really appreciate it. I think it's your... I believe this is the first time we are seeing you here, Fat Guy 925. Right, so... we are currently working on a tree generator. I have a feeling... at some point, I am going to have to play... Logic Box. Okay, that for some reason did not work. Oh, right, because our tree generator was disabled. Just seeing your name, fat guy. Alright, our tree is not generating. I don't know if it's because of the way tree generator works. Oh! Great Permutator is on sale for just $3. I will check it out. Alright, so it does look like our tree trunk is not working, right? Because this should be... we should set this to true. That's what's going on. And also, let's name this. I should just rename this. This is so... my trunk dot name equals to tree thing. Tree trunk. There we go. Austin Chain. Hello. Yes, that is correct. I am Asian. Oh, I see. Do you guys actually just browse stream Steam? Because I only know about games when... through Twitter or Reddit. And I don't actually just like... okay, so it is being made. For some reason, it's just not getting made in the... oh, right, because I'm setting... God, I'm so stupid. I'm setting the position to the origin point. Hence... alright, so... this is why you chose to just name the objects that you were generated, so you can actually tell what they are. Who are we talking about here? Alright, so... okay, let me delete all of these. And we are going to hit... and hit run, and then... that's the kind of really annoying thing. I should get David to come in and just show me how to make... how to generate... how to create editor tools instead of having to rely on this. So, there we go. There is our tree trunk. So, what I want to do next is work on another tree trunk, but this time it should be... right, but it's like this time I'd want it to be... positioned this way. So... how do I do this? Like, I'm trying to think of the position of this in relation to that right now, and if this is five, the midpoint, like, it's got to take the height of it and subtract 0.75, divide and subtract half of it from the top of this piece, and then we would add it to the position. Okay, right, what it's got to do, it's like, so right now I'm trying to figure out the position of this green piece in relation to, like, we get the midpoint, but it's got to be offset from 0.75, because this is 0.5 wide. So it's got to offset it from 0.75 from the top of this. So we get the position of this, take the height of it, divide it by 2, subtract 0.75, and then we would have this here, and then we'd want to move it out. And then we would actually want to move it out to here, the midpoint of this, and also add 0.75, so it's offset from this surface. So... okay. Let's not worry about rotation right now. Let's calculate position of next trunk. Yes. Please use paper. No, you are absolutely right. I'm just being lazy. Yeah, normally what I do is I kind of write scripts this way, use paint, and then I do it in a very rough way, and then eventually I get frustrated with all the bugs that I'm having, and then I just sit down and actually do everything on paper. So, what do we say? Let's get the position. So, first, all right, next. Vector 3, next position. So, next position equals to position of this trunk plus height divided by 2 minus trunk width divided by 2. Right. What the fuck? Right, of course, because, right, because that's a vector 3. I understand this is the float. Thing is, I'm trying to think about it, how I can do it so that it's local. Oh, that's going to be a real pain. Offset. And then let's take this. Plus offset and ridge trunk. Now, of course, what's going to happen is I am going to get if height is greater than 3.0f, then we create another trunk. Because I don't want this to go on infinitely. So, Actually, no, the first thing we need to put in is the height, so let's make that 1.5. We'll do next position, and we'll just pass on the same. We'll pass on the same quaternion as the rotation. So first, what I want to do is save everything. Fat guy, what are you talking about? I mean, when I'm streaming, it's mostly sort of like a more relaxed way of programming and not really working. Not like for real development. Alright, so. What's slowing down the editor so much? No, we have like a bunch of game objects that have like, that are generating problems, and I'm just kind of too lazy to fix them right now. It's sort of saving it for Chris to work on. Chris is one of the programmers that are working on it. Could I showcase the game for someone that has just joined? Hello, D Magister. Well, yes, because we're going to go into play right now, so. Yeah, I'll talk to Chris about it. I don't know why there is so much. So this is not really what the game looks like. But you have this core mechanic where you can walk up to a surface and change the direction of gravity and walk on different surfaces. So this is not kind of a typical level. This is a sandbox level that lets me test out different mechanics. So there's just like a bunch of work in progress stuff here, and it's all really messy. Now what's really cool is that the world is actually wraps around in 3D. So if you look at that piece with the kind of the cross, what you'll see here is eventually we can actually land on top of it if we continue to fall. So this is probably much more, maybe more what the level looks like, but you can see these boxes, you can pick them off of trees, you can use them to solve puzzles. Yeah, this is a very buggy work in progress build of the game. And, you know, let's continue our series of notes for Chris. Chris, 2015-07-29, fix editor bugs. Hello, Denim Man. How's it going? I think you are new as well. Thank you for joining. So anyway, basically, you saw those trees. What I'm doing right now is I am trying to write a generator to generate trees for me so I don't have to build them by hand, which is what I was doing. Okay, so it looks like we got the second one in the right position, right? But now we just need to offset it from there. The thing is, a lot of it... The problem is it depends on the rotation. Like, if this is... Yeah, fuck, my editor is super slow. Alright, let's actually add some more black, sharp edges, and grills love black and edges. What? Fat guy 925, I have no idea what you were talking about. All right, let's see here. I do use source control, yes. It would be insane not to. All right, so here's the tree generator. We're making another tree. All right, so this is... Yeah, I'm just trying to figure out how to do the... how to calculate the rotation of it. It's actually really hard to calculate. It's like it's really annoying to try to figure out how these things should orient themselves. How to deal with quaternions. Right, because there's basically one of four. Global rotation for transform and local rotation for rotating it. Yeah, it needs to remember the rotation from the previous guy. Which is what I have here in my fractal generator. I've done it. Actually, right now the thing is I'm inside this one. I never took it. I never did figure out how to set the quaternion to rotate something. How do I like Unity rotate locally? Is transform the local rotation anyway? Maybe there's like a quaternion for rotating 90 degrees to the right. Let me see if this works. It's like, do I set my, because I want to set my position. It's like, I move it up here. I move it up to the middle so that it's lined up with this guy. Right, the top. And then I rotate it and then move it in the direction. move it in its own direction. Came up with a graphical ideas for the game I'm developing, and also named Parabola Shift. One of the new graphical ideas is a new texture. It's a light blue grass variant that would be the default grass, and the trees will be a dirty white. Hello, Black River Elixir. Is that a puzzle game? I'm actually having a bit of a hard time imagining what you mean. You just mean bluegrass. Oh, never mind. No, the position is fine. Let's leave that there. What you want is the rotation. Right, so at some point, right, so here's the rotation. My trunk. Except the rotation should be set after position. My trunk dot transform dot rotation equals to rotation. Calculate, okay, so this should be, let's set that down here. Calculate rotation. And it should be my trunk dot. Actually, I know this isn't correct because it's not passing it down. It's not passing down the next one. But it will be good enough as a test right now. I also don't actually want it to rotate on. Let's do this. Right, for some reason this doesn't work. Is Quaternion Euler even a thing? Okay, it looks like it is. Okay, I don't understand why this isn't working. Oh, right. Fucking, hey, God. That was stupid. Forgot the F behind the float values. Blue shift. In algebra, I can never figure out how to the parabola shift, and it frustrated me to the core. Shift just sounds pretty cool, yes. Oh, cool. How far along are you, Black River Elixir? Alright, so. Actually, no. This is my next rotation. Next rotation. And that should be quaternion, not a vector 3. Man, it is. My mind is just like. My brain. Okay, let's delete all of these tree trunks. Oh man, your computer's in shop. So, had this super frustrating experience. I needed a laptop, so I bought a Razer, and it came. I bought like last year's model, and it showed up, and the tab key doesn't work. Right, so I call them, and they're like, "Okay, well, we'll send you. First, you need to send it back to us before we'll send you a new one." But in order to send it back, I gotta like wait for them to send me a box to ship it back in, and then today FedEx didn't deliver it to the right address. So that's been a week. Now I gotta wait another few days for FedEx to sort that out. 2 days to send it back, 2 days for them to send it to me, and then it's gonna take me a whole day to set up Windows the way I like it. So it's like I won't have a laptop for a month. So yeah, I know everyone has said really great things about Razer, and I'm really happy that they're paying all the devs that we kind of dropped the ball on, but so far it hasn't been super amazing. Oh, okay, it looks like it was rotated, but of course we don't know. We can't see what the rotation looks like because we made it an actual cube. So let me try that again. Oh, so plus I think I want to make the color different. All right, let's try this again. Yeah, it was really annoying. Cause it's like, I mean, their laptops are not cheap. So, and now it's got me worried. It's like, well, if I order a laptop and the tap key doesn't work, who knows how well these machines are going to hold up. And the warranty's only for a year. So, but I really need a laptop so I can like, show people the game when I'm traveling and all that. Alright, let's try this tree generator. Let's see if we're getting it to work. There we go. Aha! So yes, we have rotated it correctly. Oh, I see. That sounds really cool. Well, Black River Elixir, if you ever want to be a guest on the stream and talk about, get feedback, do be on the critique, let me know, you know? It would be kind of cool, especially when it's early on. I think that's always when it's most helpful. So, I guess what I'm saying is set rotation. Rotation to next trunk. Can... Okay, so trunk can, trunk piece can be either horizontal or vertical. If vertical, next piece has to be horizontal, vice versa. So that means, I think, create trunk, we also need Boolean is vertical. So I guess we also need that. Cause basically what I'm thinking is if this is a vertical piece, right? This next horizontal piece can actually point in any of the four directions. If it is horizontal, then we really only want it pointing down for the next piece. Right, or up, depending on which direction we roll the trunk in. So, all right. Well, that's the start of the tree generator. I'm definitely getting a better sense of the rules as I'm starting to program it as well. But my brain is a little fried, so I think we're gonna call it an end for the stream today. And we'll probably pick up from here again tomorrow, kind of continue working on this tree generating script using ProBuilder. And yeah, and for those of you who are new and you're enjoying the stream, please follow that Let's Twitch know that I'm serious, and also mostly just so that we can get the quality adjustment feature. It's prioritized, but they'll let me stream at 1080 while you people can adjust whatever setting they want. And I'll be back tomorrow at 8:30 p.m. Central, and then on Friday we will have Ian Sundstrom on the show talking about his game Stacks on Stacks on Stacks. So, all right, you guys, have a good night.